I'm Bernadette Melnick, and I am delighted to be presenting the very first module of our evidence-based practice MOOC course. I am going to be making a very strong case for evidence-based practice. My dream several years ago was that evidence-based practice would be in the DNA of every practicing clinician by 2020. Unfortunately, even though EBP has been ramping up in institutions across the country, we have a long way to go before every clinician, every healthcare system is consistently implementing an evidence-based approach to care. I have long had a philosophy, and that philosophy is, in God we trust, but everybody else better bring data to the table. I have long lived that philosophy in raising my three daughters. In fact, my youngest daughter came home last holiday and said, "Mom and Dad, I know you're going to be getting me a new iPad for Christmas, but I brought you the evidence on why you should pay $150 more and get me this iPad instead of the one I know that you're going to get me." So if we can teach children how to do evidence-based decision-making, there is no reason that we cannot teach every health sciences student from the minute they walk in the door how to deliver great evidence-based care and make the best evidence-based decisions. Well, healthcare throughout the globe really does need improvement. There are still way too many errors occurring in the healthcare system. There is a lot of wasteful healthcare spending that goes on because, again, every nurse practitioner, physician, pharmacist, optometrist is not consistently implementing evidence-based practice. Inconsistent delivery of care leads to, again, a lot of non-standardized implementation, a lot of variation in our healthcare systems, and then wasting of billions and billions of dollars every single year. Research has supported that we could reduce healthcare spending by 30%. If every single clinician throughout the world delivered evidence-based care. I was very passionate about evidence-based practice when I really started pushing this movement in the late 1990s, but I became even more passionate about evidence-based care when we almost lost our youngest daughter, Kaylin, in Australia about 10 years ago. We were off for our dream trip to Australia. I was going to speak over there at Melbourne, but we were going to tour Sydney, the Great Barrier Reef, scuba dive that. It was our real dream. We left Los Angeles. Kaylin was entirely healthy. She ate a big ice cream sundae before we boarded the plane from Los Angeles to New Zealand. 3 hours from landing in New Zealand, she woke me up and she said, "Mom, I have a terrible bellyache." and I felt her forehead. She had a low-grade fever, and within a half an hour, she started vomiting. I woke my husband up. I am a seasoned pediatric nurse practitioner, and I said to my husband, John, I think Kaylin has early appendicitis. He said, what? That can't be. She was perfectly healthy when we left Los Angeles. I said, John, trust my expertise. I really think she has early appendicitis. He said, oh no, Bern, don't you remember? About 4 or 5 days ago, I had this terrible gastroenteritis. He said, I'm sure that's what she has. I said, we're not taking any chances. We're taking her right in and getting her evaluated. So we took her to a medical facility in New Zealand. I told the physicians there what I believed was her problem. They examined her, drew some blood work, said, no, absolutely not. This is your husband's GI virus that he had 4 or 5 days ago. So we took her back to the hotel. I was palpating her belly at least 14 times a day for rebound and for guarding. Within 48 hours, her fever went away, pain subsided, vomiting stopped, and my husband said, see, Bern, you were being the overprotective pediatric nurse practitioner mom. She did not have appendicitis. So I said, okay, I was wrong. We traveled then to Sydney. We were in Sydney for 4 days. She still didn't look quite right, although Kaylin was not running a fever anymore, or she wasn't vomiting. But again, she didn't look quite right, and her appetite wasn't good. We flew then to the Australian outback. The third night we were there, she woke us up groaning in her sleep. She had 104.5 fever. And I said to my husband, I knew it. We blew it. She had appendicitis. Now we're into an abscess, and this is a very serious problem. So we boarded the next plane. We flew to Cairns, Australia, went right in there to a medical facility. They drew her blood. She had a 33,000 white blood cell count, a 92% neutrophilia, and a 36% stabs. A huge shift to the left. They evaluated her. They had a surgeon come into the emergency room. He actually had her jumping up and down on her right foot, saying, when a child can do this, she doesn't have a belly issue going on. I told them the sequence of events. I begged for a simple, low-cost ultrasound. Nobody was listening to me. They were not even going to admit her, but I was so insistent, they decided to admit her to the pediatric unit. She was called a soft admission. I was labeled a stressed out nurse mom from the United States. I went through 16 hours of telling the story to about 8 different physicians. And by then, my daughter had really started to deteriorate. She was bacteremic by then, getting septicemic. I was crying and begging the last physician to just do an ultrasound of her abdomen. See, Kaylin confused people because throughout this whole time, she had a soft belly, so she wasn't presenting with the typical signs. She had a retrocecal appendix, and as a result, people didn't think she had an abdominal issue going on. Finally, because she was deteriorating, the last physician said, okay, let's go ahead and get the ultrasound. They took her to ultrasound, which showed a big abscess in her belly. And again, by then, she was seriously ill. A public surgeon came in to evaluate her. He looked at us and he said, your daughter is too sick to operate. So what we're going to do is put her on triple high IV dose antibiotics for 6 weeks in hopes the body will wall the abscess off, and then we'll go in and do elective surgery. Being a former pediatric critical care nurse, I knew my daughter wasn't going to make it another 24 to 48 hours. I am there sobbing, thinking this was our dream trip, and we could seriously be bringing our daughter home in a box. As I cried, thank heaven for her pediatric nurse who said, Bern, we have socialized medicine over here. And as an American, you have a right to call in a private surgeon. I said, please get me the best surgeon you have here in town. She did. He came in, took one look at Kaylin, and said, if we don't get her to the operating room immediately, we could lose her. They took her off to the operating room, flushed her abdomen for over 2 hours because her whole peritoneal cavity was filled with pus. By then, it was 10 days from onset of her symptoms to this operation. Many children would not have lived through this experience. What I want to relate to you is, thank heaven my daughter lived, but if I wouldn't have been as persistent in advocating for treatment for my daughter, I really do believe she would have died. My input, my preferences, which are a huge part of evidence-based practice, were not taken into consideration. So, evidence-based practice is a problem-solving approach to the way we deliver healthcare that integrates the best evidence from well-designed studies and combines it with a clinician's expertise and patient's preferences and values. When all three of those components interact on a consistent basis, we make the best clinical decisions, which lead to the best outcomes. We can have clinicians well-skilled in evidence-based practice, but if they don't live in a culture and an environment that supports evidence-based practice, it is not going to be sustained. Later on in the course, we're going to be talking about how do you create these cultures and environments for evidence-based practice so it can be in the DNA of every practicing clinician. Everywhere I go, people ask me, Bern, how much evidence do we need to make a practice change? And I always tell people that the level or strength of the evidence, whether it's a level 1 systematic review of randomized controlled trials, which is the strongest level of evidence to guide our practices, plus the quality of that research that gives us the confidence to act. This is why critical appraisal of the evidence is such an important part of evidence-based practice. So, great formula to remember: level or strength of evidence plus its quality, which we determine through critical appraisal, gives us the confidence to act.